Good morning, students. How are you? I hope you all slept well yesterday. All right. Today we are going to talk on educational leadership, classroom management, and teacher capacity building. At the end of the lesson, I would like us to know, first of all, to be able to describe the concept of educational leadership. Secondly, we'll be able to demonstrate effective classroom management. And thirdly, enumerate the methods of teacher capacity building. So we are talking about three objectives. The first one, we are going to describe concept of educational leadership. The concept of educational leadership. We are going to take it one after the other. So we now start with educational leadership. And we say that educational leadership involves working with teachers and other education professionals, so as to be able to bring up a systematic plan to improve education as a whole. Educational leadership has some other factors under it. The first one is there are different types of educational leadership. Number one is instructional leadership. Instructional leadership focuses on students' core business. That is, it focuses on the teaching and learning of students and how they are progressing. The second one is transformational leadership. Transformational leadership is concerned with the commitment of colleagues, their leading change, and how they improve their performance. We have the third type of educational leadership, that is moral leadership. Moral leadership emphasizes on the values, the vision, an ethical part of leadership. We have participative leadership. Participative leadership stresses the importance of including colleagues in decision making. Participative leadership talks about shared leadership. Everybody is involved in decision making as regards education. The fifth one is managerial leadership. Managerial leadership focuses on the importance of defining functions, tasks, and behaviors of each leader. What each leader is supposed to do is specified. And finally, the last type of leadership we have is contingency leadership. This type of leadership highlights how leaders respond to the particular circumstances and challenges they face in the course of carrying out their duties. To say that leadership is a major factor as regards school operation cannot be overemphasized. You all know, you students, you know that even as the principal of the school, there are certain things, if not all, that you students participate in, that I participate in. For instance, when you come to school in the morning, we normally clean up the compound. I don't go and stay in my staff room. I'm always with you people, picking the pieces of paper, saying sweep here, sweep here, sweep there. And that's why you also see my colleagues, your teachers, they come and stand with me. We all work together. Because if I stay in my office and I ask you people to work, I ask the teachers to work, that is no leadership. Everyone will just go and stay wherever the person is. But in our training and our workshop, we have always been taught about shared leadership. You cannot do it on your own. When there is shared leadership, everybody will contribute his or her own quota, and that will make the school to excel. At this point, I would like to also explain to us what we mean by teacher leader. We have what we call a teacher leader is one who inspires a positive school culture. A teacher leader is the one that is in charge when it comes to classroom management. And how do we facilitate all this? We can facilitate professional growth of teachers through professional learning community, what we call PLC. We can be a mentor to new teachers. We can design school policy. I'm just trying to pick them because the points are so many that I don't want you students to get confused. So I'm picking them one after the other so that we all know how to go about it. But the fact is that a teacher is a leader. You find out that when teachers come to teach, when I come to teach French, for instance, I am in charge of my class. The teacher is the one that controls and the students follow. Though at times it's an interactive session, but the teacher must always be on top of the situation. Don't forget that I told you we have three different topics to treat today. We have finished on educational leadership. The second one we are going to talk about again is on classroom management. Classroom management. The classroom management are just actions and strategies that we teachers use to solve the problem of order in classrooms. You students, you know yourselves that even as I'm standing talking, as when I'm not having any eye contact with you, some of you will be opening your bags, or some of you, if possible, may even want to drink water, or some of you may be playing some pranks. But when I teach Ambani, for when I have a good classroom, the only way I can exhibit a good classroom management is to make sure that I am focused with each and every one of you. There is that eye contact. I'm able to, though I have two eyes, but I should be able to have some eyes behind too, eyes by the side, so to be able to get you all. If not, the teaching and learning will not be smooth. We talk about classroom organization. This focuses on the physical environment. We make sure that the classroom is safe enough. If the classroom is not well organized, if, for instance, in this your classroom, the lockers are not well placed, the tables are not well placed, the blackboards, the duster, the chalks, if everything is on top of each other, in the course of my teaching, you can hear, boah, something will fall. And when something falls, it can fall on your head, the table can pour, the water on the table can pour, thereby staining your books. Even a child that might want to sit down may not sit down well, and the child might fall, and in the process, the child might wound himself or herself. So classroom organization is very good. Even in the class, when the classroom is organized, well organized, when a teacher enters the class, the teacher feels happy. When the students are in the class, they are able to concentrate. But when the classroom is jagra-jagra, you know what I mean by jagra-jagra? Yes, I know you know. When the classroom is jagra-jagra, you will not be able to comprehend very well. And this we don't want to encourage. So classroom organization optimizes student learning and it reduces distractions. Because when the tables are falling, when everything is scattering, you students will not be able to concentrate. Will you be able to concentrate? No, you won't be able to concentrate. But when the classroom is well organized, you come in, you sit down, you are focused, just like we have in Nigerian Korean Model School. Can't you see how everything is organized? All the lockers, your names are written against all the lockers. When you come, your numbers are on the table. When you come, you know this is where you're supposed to sit. You sit down. Sadder too, you know that your chair is chair number 36. Once you come to the class, you sit down. You arrange your books very well under the tables. The television set is there, all the multimedia equipment are all well arranged for effective teaching. And finally, we talk about expectations for student behavior. Having given you a good classroom management and then making sure that the classroom is well organized, you students too, we expect a lot from you. And what do we expect from you? We expect you to behave in a manner that can contribute to a positive classroom environment. You know, whenever I enter the class, I say, students, don't make noise. If you make noise, no matter how organized the classroom is, no matter how organized the teacher is, if you are making noise, the learning, teaching and learning will not take place. So it becomes for you students of Nigerian Korean Model School, which I always tell you, to be well behaved, well mannered. When you come to class, you come in gently, you sit down gently. When you want to answer a question, you put up your hands. No noise making. Is that not what I keep telling you people? You don't make noise. You don't just stand up and start walking from one side to the other. You don't start talking to your colleagues. No. You don't start opening your bag anyhow. No. In Nigerian Korean Model School, once you're in the class, you behave yourself. Focus gently. When it's time for break, then you can go out and play. But once you're in the class, it is not time to play. Thirdly, the last but not the least topic for today is teacher capacity building. I hope you can all see my handwriting. You can see my handwriting, I hope. Okay. What is teacher capacity building? Teacher capacity building refers to any effort that is being made either by the government, either by an individual, either by institution, to be able to improve the abilities of a teacher. There is need for a teacher. There is need for me to train, to be trained and be trained. I've always told you people that before the school started in September last year, we have been attending trainings and workshops and seminars. I went to South Korea for capacity building training. And since I came back from South Korea, even in Nigeria here, yeah, we've been having trainings that are being organized by the Korean government. And why do we need this training? I need this training to be able to improve my ability, because things change. The only thing that is constant is change. Every day things are changing. And if you don't move with the trend, you'll be left behind. It's not the same strategy that I used to teach today that I may use to teach tomorrow. But how will I be able to change my teaching strategies? It's by being trained. And that has been taking place. And so the training has been able to enhance my performance abilities. That's why I can stand here to talk to you people and to teach you. And when I teach you, you understand. In Nigeria, we have institutions that organize teacher capacity that enhances the capacity of teachers as regards training. The first one we have is Teachers Registration Council of Nigeria. I'm a teacher, a friend teacher. For me to be a professional teacher, I must have what they call, I must be registered with Teachers Registration Council of Nigeria. Before, it used to be just registration like that, but now you have to sit for an exam to tell you how important it is. And the federal government has now told us that any teacher by December this year that does not have this certificate will no longer be a teacher. That's to tell you how important it is to be registered. The second one is the Nigerian National Teachers Institute. National Teachers Institute is where teachers that want to improve on their academic abilities go to get training. Some teachers come in as NCE holders, or before they used to come in, I don't think they have that one, but NCE holders, yes. Or any teacher, if you want to learn, if you want to become a professional teacher, you go to NTI, National Institute of National Teachers Institute, and you go there and you get training for you to be able to live up to expectation. Because this National Teachers Institute is fully committed to capacity building, both for the primary and the secondary school teachers. We also have models of teacher capacity building in Nigeria. The workshop model and the school-based teacher professional support model are the major ways teacher capacity building activities are carried out in Nigeria. So for summary, my students, I want to summarize by saying that there is a seamless connection between educational leadership, teacher capacity building. What are we saying? All of them are interwoven. Educational leadership, classroom management, and teacher capacity building. All of them, one helps other. Well, this one helps this one, this one helps this one. Three of them come together to be able to make me a professional teacher that I am supposed to be. If I don't have an educational leadership as the principal of the school, Nigerian Korean Model School will collapse, because I lead, my teachers follow, my students follow. Though the leadership is not individualized, because now we are talking about teamwork. Teamwork comes into play. Shared leadership comes into play. But being the principal, I'll be the one that will initiate it. I'll be the one to be able to think outside the box. I'll be the one to be the critical thinker, to be able to initiate ideas, and then my colleagues will follow. And if I have this leadership, then when I come to the classroom as a teacher, I'll be able to exhibit it in the classroom. The leadership will not only be in making sure the teachers come to school on time, or making sure the school compound is swept, or making sure that parents pay the school, do what they're supposed to do for their children. No. The leadership will also be manifested in the classroom. When I come to the classroom to teach, I'll be able to manage my classroom. When I come to the classroom to teach, I'll be able to make sure that at the end of the lesson, my students are able to pick, are able to understand, are able to grasp the objectives of the lesson. I should be able to control the students. The control is not just only outside. I should be able to control the students also in the classroom. And then, of course, the capacity building. If I just become French teacher of, I'm a French teacher that graduated, let's say, 2004. And since that 2004 till 2019, I've not attended any capacity building. Then I'm a stone. There is nothing new. But we know that everything in life is dynamic. Learning is a continuous process. And so for us to achieve our global excellence, which is our key in this school, we have to move with the trends as regards education. I don't know if you have understood what I... Have you understood me? Does anybody have any question? So if I ask you questions on education leadership, classroom management, and teacher capacity building, you can explain? Okay, Isaiah, tell me, what does education leadership mean? Okay, is he correct? Fine, okay, clap for him. Sarah, what about classroom management? What have you understood by classroom management? No, there's a word that is missing. Who can help him? Who can help Sarah? Fatima. Okay, Fatima, let's hear you. Very good. Clap for Fatima. Well done. What about teacher capacity building? If you know it, put up your hand. Razak. Yes, teacher capacity building. Okay, Razak has told us now that the National Institute of National Teachers Institute is in Kaduna. Is that what you have told us? Clap for Razak. Okay, excellent. All right, nobody has any other question. Okay, it's time for break. So I wish you will go out and play. And don't forget that when you come into the classroom, you should maintain your organization in your classroom and don't disturb. Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Thank you.